Vampires. Nosferatu. Draculas. Dracula Backwardses. Whatever you want to call them, undead blood-sucking creatures of the night have long been a source of fear and fascination alike for folks around the globe. Also arousal, but I'm getting ahead of myself. Vampires are a fixture of every kind of fiction under the shade, and of course, anime is no exception to that rule. Also, of course, anime being anime, the way those vampires are conceived and depicted varies wildly from work to work. So today, both in honor of how it's currently Spooky Month, and because fall has given us three new bloodsucker shows to sink our fangs into, I'd like to highlight some of the coolest and most creative ways that anime has implemented vampires over the years. Horror has never been anime's forte as a format, that's always been more manga's thing, and just by the by, if you want to read some great horror manga, Bookwalker is currently running a huge Halloween sale where you can get 30% coin back on the likes of Mieruko-chan and School Live, not to mention every Monster Girl thing ever made. And that's on top of the 600 yen discount you get with the promo code BASEMENT at checkout, but I digress. A rare few anime do succeed at being scary, and we'll talk about one of the best of them by the time this video's over, but by and large, if an anime is heavy on blood and guts, they're probably a byproduct of dark, brutal action rather than slow-burning dread. And that sort of action is the stock and trade of one of anime's most famous vampires, Alucard Hellsing, who gleefully inflicts it on his fellow vamps, any human who happens to get in the way, and especially the goddamn Nazis. As a vampire, the tools Alucard has at his disposal to inflict brutal violence are as numerous as the fucks he has to give are limited. Super speed and strength, hypnosis and shapeshifting come standard in the vampire package, but he also has ESP and telekinesis, and that's not even getting into what all the souls he's devoured and can control at will are capable of. Dude's a one-man army, basically, and like many other OP anime protagonists, a lot of the fun in Hellsing simply comes from watching him brutally deliver what other monsters have coming. Now, dial that power level back a smidge and you get Vampire Hunter D, a Dampir, or half-vampire, kinda like Blade, who also coincidentally has his own studio madhouse anime, though I only bring that up to warn you not to watch it. D has devoted his life to wandering a post-apocalyptic wasteland called the Frontier, and using his powers, both the vampiric ones he was born with and the magic he's studied over the millennia, to defend the last remnants of humanity and hunt down the vampiric nobility who plotted the pre-post-apocalypse in the first place. That Hellsing connection probably isn't a coincidence either. The original Vampire Hunter D novels were a hugely influential, generational sensation back in the 80s, and as such, though he hasn't appeared in many anime himself, D should be considered the progenitor of pretty much every anime vamp out there today. And not just as a character archetype. Many of the book's unique lore notions about vampires have become genre staples in Japan. For example, the whole plot of Dance in the Vampire Bund, not to be confused with all the plot in Dance in the Vampire Bund, is built around asking what would happen if D's secret society of noble vampires tried to coexist with humanity instead of nuking us into submission. Aesthetically speaking, the opulent steampunk vibes of this summer's case study of Vanitas couldn't be further removed from D's dark, broody atmosphere, and its civilized, blood-averse vampires couldn't be further from D's monsters. And yet, in its world-building, its approach to esoteric magic and mysticism, and its structuring of vampire society, that influence can still be strongly felt. That said, Vanitas does frame vampirism more like a shonen power system than a curse, using it as a basis for fun and frantic fantasy action as opposed to the more brutal battles we've seen in the series we've looked at so far. It's far from the only anime to take that approach either, though typically battle anime that involve vampires or vampire-like beings tend to cast them in the villain roles. You expected an example, but it was me! Dio! As well as all the other vampires and pillar men in JoJo who, I mean, most of their powers, like flash freezing their whole bodies or shooting high-pressure jets of fluid out of their eyes, are entirely divorced from any and all other vampire fiction ever, and they don't even suck blood with their teeth. Although, honestly, the finger-jabbing thing is even creepier. JoJo just goes to show that nerds will accept pretty much anything as a vampire, so long as it snacks on blood, can't get a tan, and doesn't sparkle. And as such, I'd argue that the demons of Demon Slayer also should totally count as anime vampires, if only on a technicality. But if a technicality's not good enough for you, and you demand to see only proper, certified vampires fighting your dudes with samurai swords, anime still has you covered. Seraph of the End, or Seraph of the Edge as we so affectionately called it back in the day, is another take on Dee's secret vampire society takes over the world bit, though this time, instead of nukes, the vampires used a bioweapon to wipe out most of the adults on Earth before taking the world's children in as livestock. As the story begins, a few of those livestock kids try to make a break for it, but only one of them, Yuichiro, survives the attempt. And he vows revenge, of course, on the blood-sucking monsters that killed his orphan family. Luckily, as Yu quickly discovers once he makes it outside, he won't have to take that revenge alone, as there's a whole human resistance movement working to push back the vampire menace using special cursed samurai swords imbued with the power of demons that only a select few warriors have the strength of will to wield without losing their souls. But if he wants to get his hands on one of those swords, Yu's gonna have to learn a thing or two about friendship first. This is still a shonen battle anime, after all. Once he does, though, things get wild, unpredictable, and dark pretty fast, in what is still one of Wit Studio's most beautifully animated and aesthetically striking productions. The manga's pretty damn gorgeous, too, and still ongoing in the Shonen Jump app, if you're curious. If I had to pick a favorite example of animated vampire fighting action, the bloody brutality of Netflix's Castlevania would be pretty close to the top. Its monsters can be genuinely scary at times, which is rare within this medium, and it's always fun watching them get eviscerated. Though it's also almost equally fun watching the vampire villains sit around vamping at each other and plotting their nefarious deeds. There's some really fun personalities on both sides of the cast, and some fascinating fantasy politics going on. Ultimately, though, Castlevania's monster battling action is surpassed by that of Kekkai Sensen. Unsurprisingly, since Kekkai Sensen is a Studio Bones joint, and they've kinda been the undisputed kings of anime action ever since Sword of the Stranger dropped back in 2007. Vanitas is also their work, and features plenty of top-tier, over-the-top fights in its own right, but the sheer, ridiculous scale of Kekkai Sensen's action, combined with its unusually playful animation and the inventive nature of its blood-based power system, not to mention the fun New York backdrop, just hits the Sakuga Goblin in my brain on a whole other level. And while its heroes do spend most of their time fighting things other than vampires, whenever one of the rare and powerful blood breeds does make an appearance, their strength is devastating and intimidating on a whole other level. With that said, do be aware going in that Kekkai Sensen is more of an action comedy than a pure action series, and set your expectations accordingly. Speaking of comedy, that's another thing anime really likes to use vampires for, and why not? A lot of them are funny looking, immortality makes them natural slapstick punching bags, and they're all such huge cosplay dorks. Genndy Tartakovsky understood that perfectly when he made the best Adam Sandler movies, and The Vampire Dies in No Time, simulcasting now on Funimation, understands it just as well. As the title suggests, and as I covered in the last ones to watch, the big central joke of The Vampire Dies in No Time is that the vampire, Draluk, turns to dust if you so much as mention garlic to him. This unfortunate condition has forced him into the unlife of a pathetic gamer recluse, and when, due to an unfortunate misunderstanding, a famous vampire hunter burns Draluk's house down, he gets to add Couchsurfing Freeloader to that inauspicious title. So it's basically a buddy comedy where one of the guys is constantly dying. That's a fun gag. And on top of that, the show's loose world-building around vampires does some really fun things with the concept. Framing them more like common pests and public health hazards than the dark and mysterious creatures of the night we're so used to. 2013's Blood Lad had a similar character gag going with its vampire otaku protagonist, Staz, who wants to be a human so he can play video games and watch anime all day. The big difference being that Staz is actually a badass when push comes to shove, the boss of a sort of vampire yakuza gang type thing, and he also gets in some fights and stuff, which are pretty fun to watch. If you put a stake to my heart and demanded I pick an absolute favorite vampire-themed comedy anime, I think I'd have to go with Assassin's Pride, which follows the adventures of secret vampire assassin who no one knows is a vampire because he keeps it so darn secret, Kufa Vampire. I made a whole video about that one if you want to check it out. But if we're restricting this exclusively to shows that are funny on purpose, then I guess my second pick would be Jitsuwa Watashiwa, or Actually I Am, which follows Asahi Kuromine, a hapless teen boy with the world's worst poker face, who finally works up the courage to ask out his crush Yoko, only to discover that actually, she's a vampire. And now, unless he wants her dad to pull her out of school, he's gonna have to help her keep that secret, which is hard for him on account of the poker face thing I mentioned earlier. Also, the class president's a tiny alien in a schoolgirl-shaped mech, the principal's a demon, and somehow, Asahi ends up having to protect their secrets as well. Now, admittedly, the manga version of Jitsuwa Watashiwa, available as My Monster Secret on Bookwalker, is substantially better than the anime, but any way you choose to experience it, this unconventional harem comedy is a laugh riot. If you'd prefer a more conventional harem comedy, though, Rosario and Vampire has you covered, and makes an interesting counterpoint to Jitsuwa Watashiwa. It's about an ordinary human boy who ends up having to attend a school for monsters due to his bad grades, and has to keep his identity under wraps or else he'll get eaten. Mocha, a cute vampire girl with a sexy dom alter ego, is his chief ally in protecting this secret, but it's not long before they're joined in the harem by a Yuki Onna, a little witch, and a succubus. Nice. This, of course, brings us to the last thing that anime likes to do with vampires because it can't do horror: get the other kind of freaky with them. If you think about it, the whole vampire coven concept is basically a pre-built harem anime waiting to happen, so it makes perfect sense that Strike the Blood exists. Although the vampire aspects don't really play into it all that much. They're more like a spicy supernatural condiment on top of an otherwise bland cookie-cutter fighting light novel story about a really strong guy and all the girls who want to fuck him. That's lame. If I'm watching a horny vampire story, I want to be horny for the vampire, not the human familiars. On that note, you'll come to the new fall show, Irina Vampire Cosmonaut, for its fascinating alternate history riff on the space race, but you'll stay for its immaculately detailed animated mouths. Also, maybe the dog collars. And all of that alt history space race stuff is still really good even after it gets horny, and its interpretation of vampires as an oppressed people in the USSR is super interesting too, but like, the attention to detail on those fangs and lips, man. Just think about how much time that must have taken to draw. That's dedication. Now, I'd be remiss if I didn't point out that anime is fairly equal opportunity with its vampire thirst. The whole wispy Bishonen archetype was basically tailor-made to be a Dracula, and from Trinity Blood to Vampire Knight to Diabolic Lovers to Noblesse, there's a ton of anime out there for the Twilight crowd to enjoy. I haven't seen much of any of them, because I'm the type of person who only just learned this year about Bella! Where the hell have you been, loca? But they exist, and even if they're not for me, I can at least acknowledge that they're good at what they do for their target audience. And if you're in that target audience, and thirsty and desperate enough to not be bothered by one of the stupidest scripts you've ever heard in your entire life, Fall's new vampire J-Rock Battle of the Bands train wreck, Visual Prison, might do it for you too. I suppose it's worth mentioning that there's also some very wholesome vampire love stories out there. Jitsuwa Watashiwa is one of them. Mostly, but more importantly, Karin is a ridiculously cute rom-com about a vampire teen girl with a weird condition that makes her overproduce blood instead of needing to drink it, which she can then use her fangs to inject into people, improving their health and mood. Basically, she's a reverse Dracula, not to be confused with a Dracula backwards, and she's done a pretty good job so far of keeping that a secret from her human classmates, until a new boy comes to town who kicks her heart condition into a whole new gear. If you enjoy those classic fuwa fuwa doki doki sort of anime romances, Karin is pretty Kino. But that's not what you clicked on this vampire video to find out about, is it? Not this month, not this weekend of all weekends. You want to get spooked, maybe even scared. And don't worry, or do worry a lot, I guess, because I've got you covered there too. Though first, because I couldn't find anywhere else to fit it into this video, I want to quickly shout out Mars Red, one of the most underrated new shows of this year. It does have horror elements, which make use of some absolutely incredible cinematography and editing, but on the whole, it's more of a tragic period drama about an experimental vampire unit struggling to stay afloat within the murky political waters of the Imperial Japanese military circa 1920. Also, they fight a lot of other vampires, naturally. It's actually based on a play and contains a ton of theater references, which I love because I was a theater kid, but no, don't leave. I'll talk about scary stuff now. As I said at the top of the video, anime tends to struggle with horror, at least compared to cinema and manga, because much of the imagery that allows those media to elicit such visceral fear, gore, body horror, and grotesque monster designs, need to be detailed and realistic to really be scary, which simply doesn't jive with your typical fast and cheap anime production process. That doesn't have to be the case if you're working on a movie budget, though. There is some very convincingly off-putting gore to be found in the world of 80s and 90s OVAs, and, of course, Akira, but that's a story for another day. Blood, the Last Vampire is a tight 50-minute horror story produced at Production IG and directed by Hiroyuki Kitakubo of Golden Boy and Stardust Crusaders OVA fame. Also, he was basically in on the ground floor of hentai, directed episode 4 of Cream Lemon. Dude's a cream legend. But that's not the fluid animation skill that he puts to work in this movie. Blood tells the tale of a 60s schoolgirl named Saya who's secretly a katana-wielding government agent tasked with tracking down horrific, parasitic bat monsters known as chiropterans. And, like, you know the word in the title of the movie? Unsurprisingly, there's a lot of that stuff in it, and it looks super gruesome. You won't find any oversaturated anime ketchup here. Blood's blood can be legitimately hard to look at. More importantly, though, those bat monsters are creepy as fuck. Not only are their designs unnervingly gruesome and detailed enough to actually be gruesome, but the shuddery, rotoscoped way they move around hits just the right uncanny valley nerve to make you feel like you're in danger whenever they start lurching toward the screen. There was actually a spin-off TV series, Blood Plus, and a newer movie, Blood Sea, both of which have their strong points, but neither of them manages to replicate the raw discomfort that The Last Vampire so effectively evokes. Few anime really can, but that's okay, because well-executed psychological horror sticks with you longer anyway. And there are few anime in existence that have stuck with me harder, eaten away at me more, than Shiki. Shiki, like many of the best horror stories ever told, is set in a small Japanese town deep in the boonies called Sotoba. It's an old place, some might say dying, and it feels absolutely stifling to 15-year-old Megumi Shimizu, aspiring Tokyo socialite, who, until she can run away and make that dream come true, is so bored with day-to-day life that a rich family moving into the Western-style mansion outside town feels like an earth-shattering event to her. She just wants something, anything new to happen to shake things up in town. And she has that wish fulfilled when she goes missing and turns up dead. A few nights later, Yuki Natsuno, the boy Megumi was crushing on, starts seeing her staring at him from the trees through his bedroom window. A few nights after that, another villager dies, and another. The local physician is at a loss. Panic and paranoia begin gripping the populace. More and more people turn up dead, and Megumi just keeps staring through Yuki's window. Eventually, of course, they do figure out that it's vampires, but that's only the start of Shiki's descent into darkness. This show brings to light a much deeper, more human kind of evil than things that go bump in the night, and blurs the line between man and monster until it's legitimately impossible to tell which is which. I think about Shiki's final few episodes constantly. They haunt me. And the things it has to say about humanity are more relevant now than they've ever been before. It's a very good vampire anime, is what I'm saying, and you should watch it tonight if you can, especially if tonight's Halloween and you don't have other plans. It's a bit of a slow burn, but the payoff is utterly transcendent. And the OP absolutely slaps. So does the OP for The Vampire Dies in No Time, by the way. Just thought I should mention. Oh, also the Monogatari OPs. It'd be blasphemy not to at least mention those. Though calling Monogatari just a vampire anime feels horrifically, offensively reductive to me, which is why I didn't mention it earlier in the video. Definitely not because I forgot about it and I'm shoehorning this into the end of the script now in a desperate bid to keep the Monogatari fans off my back. With that, I'm kinda out of vampires. I mean, there's other ones I could have talked about, like Vampire Princess Miu, and I'd love to hear which ones of those you think I made the biggest mistake by skipping over in the comments below, but I promised myself I'd keep this video short so I'd have time to really do Happy Science Part 2 justice next weekend. So, yeah, happy Halloween. Don't forget to check out that Spookwalker ebook sale at the link in the doobly-doo, which happens to include Vampire Hunter D, Monogatari, and a bunch of the source material for other stuff I covered today. Oh, and on a completely unrelated note, Bookwalker is also selling complete series bundles of Mushoku Tensei light novels and manga for 30% off until November 17th. Of course, can also be combined with that 600 yen discount you get for using the promo code BASEMENT at checkout. Anyway, I'm Geoff Thew, professional Dracula enthusiast, signing out to go get a bite to eat. Woo! Spooky!